the journey to Granville was nothing other than normal. You know, the train seemed fine, everything seemed fine. And sitting there and chatting away, and you know, some people are reading and whatnot. And then just after we left Parramatta, there was this sudden jolting effect, and jolting forward and backwards, and the train came to a sudden halt. And you could see this huge cloud of dust out the right-hand side of the carriage, and I thought something's happened. So I stood up in my seat, and I lifted up the window on those old red rattlers, as they call them. You could lift up the windows, and I lifted up the window and went right out, right to, virtually to my stomach, and I could see right underneath the Bold Street Bridge, and I could see the first or second carriage leaning up against the retainer wall on the other side of the bridge. And as I pulled myself back into the train, I turned to my wife, who was sitting in the seat beside me, and I said, I think the train has been, and before I could get out, the rest of it being derailed, before I could get it out, the bridge came down.
Coffee or tea, whatever you like.
And the next thing I knew, I was coming back to, and I was in a crushed sort of a situation with bricks and rubble and everything around me, and bleeding and sticks sticking in my leg and cuts, and just didn't have a clue what had happened. It was just all like a dream, and just didn't know what was going on. And I turned to see where my wife was. I couldn't see her. I couldn't see through the rubble, but she somehow miraculously landed in the middle aisle of the train, and she was covered in rubble and glass and so on. She wasn't actually trapped as I was. I was pinned by my left foot. And I was there for quite a while. And before I knew it, there was people around me trying to get me out. There was a fellow in a butcher's apron, and he was cutting away at my foot. And I could hear someone yell out, don't do that, it might explode. And the first thing that went through my mind, of course, was an airplane must have crashed on the roof of the train.
When I first went in there, sometimes I couldn't get to a person's whole body. There was compression and debris there. So I had to feel the pulse in the ankle to see if they were alive, or the femoral pulse to see if they were alive. And then I'd say, can you feel me touching you? And there'd be no reply. And I'd think, well, I've got a warm limb and a bit of a pulse. So I know the person on this leg's alive, but they couldn't feel it. And so immediately I thought, well, there's spinal cord injuries. And so I thought, even if they live, if I don't, you know, treat them right in my extrication, I could sever the spinal cord. So they live, but they end up in a wheelchair. Some still had cards in their hand, playing cards. Some had magazines. Some had the old type cassette recorders, you know. And you thought, well, the suddenness of it, you know. One minute they're travelling on a train to work, and then within minutes later, some are dead. Some have spinal cord injuries that will result in them being in a wheelchair. Others have such compression injuries that they will never function properly again. It's amazing too. I was using hand tools, and like chisels and screwdrivers, and I always carried a little pocket knife in my overalls. Always, you know, you're always got a knife. And I got it out, and I was using it to cut seats, because if you cut a seat, you can get a little bit of compression off there without, you know, causing the crush syndrome problems there. Especially around the chest area where we cut the lining out of the seats and pulled, you know, springs and things out, and all sort. They were difficult, those railway seats. And that would give the chest just about 2 inches, which was, you know. And I remember one lady, she was compressed on the chest as well, and after I pulled the stuffing out of the seat, you know, she took a big gasp because she was only a respiration expansion was only at about half an inch, and then it became an inch and a half, which meant a lot to her.
Over the years, it's something that never goes. You can't hop in the car and drive at all without going under a railway bridge and remembering the whole thing. So it's people say you must forget, but it's something you don't forget and you never forget. And people say, oh, maybe you can get some sort of help for that, but I don't think you can. It's something that's in my mind, it's in my memory, and to hop in the car and go for a drive and just the association of a train, even seeing a train, but then having to drive under the railway bridges on the road, you can't do it. I've tried numerous times to stop under a railway bridge, and I've even picked out certain bridges that every time I go to drive under them, for some reason a train's going over the top, as long as if they know I'm coming. I've been down to Bold Street several times and visited the memorial there, which we actually contributed to its the erection by a small donation, because we felt we should. I mean, I'm just lucky my name's not on the wall. When any other time it probably would have been. I look at that monument there and I can picture my name being on that wall.
And it was hard to see people relaying their dreams just in conversation and realising that those dreams would probably, and you know, never come true or never be realised. And so you knew the battle that they had ahead of them if they survived, and you knew certainly that they would have to have more courage than rescue officers. That's what I always reckon, that you know, victims have got to have more courage than rescue officers, because we go down the base of a cliff or in a road extrication and get them out, and they've got, you know, months and months, sometimes years, of courageous recovery.
I'm certainly very fortunate that I'm still around and got a good wife and some terrific kids, and whom we love very much, that perhaps wouldn't be here otherwise. So, you know, we're now having a very good life and very happy about it, and we do our best to try and give something back if we can.